Have you ever tried to animate an element to an unknown height with CSS alone? If so, you probably found that it's not as easy as it seems. To animate a CSS height, you need to animate to a specific value. 100% and auto both won't work. You can transition max height, but this means that you probably need to use a random arbitrary value that may not work in all cases. It's just weird, and it may not even work depending on what you're trying to do. Well, this is something that is available with Angular animations. In this video, I'll show you how. All right, let's get to it. Now, before we get too far along, it's important to note that I've already created several videos focused on the animation framework in Angular. They cover the basics of setting up and using Angular animations, creating state-based and interleave animations, using the keyframes, query, and stagger functions to create more complex animation sequences, using the start, done animation events, and creating animations that run in parallel versus in sequence. So if any of these concepts are unfamiliar to you, you'll probably want to check those videos out first so that you're not lost in this video. And to make them easier to find, I've created an Angular animation playlist to help, so check it out. Okay, enough of that. On to the example for this video. Here we have a demo application for the Vans shoe brand. It has a sign-up form with multiple steps. After the user adds their email address, they switch to a new step where they need to create a password for their new account. This is cool, but as we switch between these two steps, it switches abruptly. It would be better to change this a little so that it feels more smooth. It would be better to transition as the user switches between the steps like this. And this is exactly what we're going to do in this video. And in order to build this exact animation, we need to animate between the varying dynamic heights of the two different form steps. Okay, let's look at the code. Here, in the template for our signup form component, we can see the two panes that we're switching between. First, we have the pane for the email address form here. Then we have the pane for the password form here. And we're using a switch to conditionally determine the appropriate step to show based on our active pane property. So this means, as far as animations go, these items will be entering and leaving the DOM as we switch between the steps. So let's switch to the code for this component. Now, let's add the animations array. Next, let's add a trigger with the trigger function. Let's name it pane change. And let's add a transition with the transition function. For this animation, we're going to animate when the active pane property value changes. And we can see that this property is a number. We want this pane change to animate anytime that number changes, so let's animate from any state to any state with asterisk, arrow, and asterisk. Okay, now we're going to add some animations. What we want to do is we want to start the pane that's entering in a hidden state while the pane that's leaving completes its transition to the hidden state. Then, once it's done, we'll animate the item entering into the view. So let's add a query, and we'll query for items entering first. Within this query, let's add the style for the hidden pane with the style function. Let's set the opacity to 0, and let's set the scale to 0.9. Okay, now we're going to add the animation for the pane that's leaving. So let's add another query. This time we'll query for items leaving. Within this, let's add the starting style. It will have an opacity of 1, and it'll have a scale of 1 too. Now let's add the animation with the animate function. Let's give it a duration of 0.2 seconds and an easing function of easeIn. Now let's add another style function to animate 2. Let's animate to an opacity of 0 and let's animate to a scale of 0.9. Okay, next we need to animate the pane that's entering. So let's add one more query. For our enter animation, we already added our starting style, so we just need the actual animation. So let's add the animate function, and we'll add the same 0.2 second duration with the ease in timing function 2. Then we need to add the final style with the style function. We'll animate to an opacity of 1 and a scale of 1, 2. Okay, so that should be it for our animation. We just need to add it to the template. So let's switch to the HTML. Now, since we set our animation up to query for items entering and leaving, we can add the animation here on the panes div, and we'll need to bind it to the active pane property so that it will be triggered when that property changes. Okay, let's save and see where we're at. Let's click on the button to switch panes. Okay, so it's a little better, but it's still not very good. It still feels very abrupt. Well, this is because the height is changing, because the content in the two panes is different. So we need to ease this height change. Well, as I mentioned earlier, this is doable with Angular animations. We do this by animating the height property and using a value of asterisk. This asterisk is a wildcard value that can be used for both height and width when we're not sure the final length value of an animating item. Okay, so let's add a height animation here. For this, we'll be animating the height of the parent element, our panes element that has the trigger. So let's start by adding another query here. This time we'll query for a value of self, which will target the item with the trigger. And within this query, let's add an animation. We'll go with the same 0.2 second duration and ease in timing function that we used for the others. Now we'll add the style function. And here we'll add height. And we'll give it a string value of asterisk. Okay, one more thing here. We don't want the height to change when the first pane is leaving. So let's group the enter and self animations with the group function so that the height will only animate when the entering item is animating after the leave has completed. Okay, now let's save and see how this looks. Let's click to advance to the next step. It looks the same, right? It's not animating the height. Well, this is because we need to provide a starting value. Now, sometimes you may know the starting value, so you can provide a hard-coded value. But here, we don't know the starting height of the container. Sometimes it'll be the height of the email step, and then others, it'll be the height of the password step. So what we need to do is provide the starting height of the element to the animation. Well, this can be done using animation params. Params allow us to pass information along to the animation so that it can use the values provided during its animation steps. We can add params with the params object on the transition function. In this object, we can define whatever params we need. So in our example, let's add params. Let's add a start height param. And we'll just give it an initial value of 0. Okay, now let's use this param for our starting style in the animation. Let's add another self query here by our enter starting style. And let's give it a starting style of our param height. To do this, we use the param name inside of double curly braces. Also, in this case, we are going to pass the client height of our element, which will give us a number value for the number of pixels it is tall. So we need to include the px unit here too. Okay, so that's how we add and use the params in the animation. Now we need to pass the value to our animation trigger in the template. So let's switch over to the template. Now, rather than bind directly to the active pane property, we're going to switch this to an object so that we can pass our params object. The first item in this object will be the value to trigger the animation, which is our active pane property. Then we can add a params object. Inside of this object, we need to add our start height. Now, what we want to do here is pass the client height of this element as the start height. To do this, let's add a template reference variable to the panes element. Okay, now we can use this element to access its client height. And that should be it. Let's save this and try it out. Nice. Now it's transitioning the height as we navigate between these two panes like we want. It looks a lot nicer, at least in my opinion, hopefully in yours too. Now remember, the asterisk not only animates unknown heights, but it can also be used for widths. I feel like, in my experience, needing to animate to unknown heights is more common, but I've definitely needed to use this technique for widths as well. So now you have another handy tool to help with animations in Angular apps. I hope you found this tutorial useful. Now remember, there's a lot to the animation framework, so I'll go ahead and stop here for now, but I will be creating more videos on Angular animations in the future, so stay tuned. Until next time, thanks for watching.